And TGIF, my friends, patriots, lovers of democracy, truth, and justice, believers in peace, freedom, and the American way. Thom Hartmann here with you. It's Friday. Of course, that means it is Brunch with Bernie. Senator Bernie Sanders taking your calls in our national town hall meeting. Hey, I hear you, Bernie. Hallelujah.
Hey, Thom. How are you?
Fine. Okay, we just have a minute and a half, I think, or so here until the break.
The thing about technology, it's fantastic when it occasionally works.
Yes, and then it doesn't.
Let me run through. We don't have much time.
Sure.
There's a lot that went on in the Senate this week, and I'll try to very, very briefly go through it. The great debate about student loans. I voted against the bill that eventually passed, offered an amendment to try to improve it. Bottom line is, it is now going to be based on variable interest rates. So as interest rates go up in years to come, which is very, very likely, it means that students and their parents will be paying substantially higher interest rates than they're paying right now.
Right.
I think given the disaster that we currently have in terms of student indebtedness, the average student is $28,000 in debt when he or she graduates college. That is a bad, bad idea. We're working now. There's going to be work begun on the Senate Finance Committee on tax reform, and I have a lot of concerns about the possibilities as to where that might go. The committee will be deluged with the needs and the pressure from large corporations who would like to see even more tax breaks than they currently have. I found it interesting that the chairman of the committee promised that the requests coming in, the proposals coming in from members of the Senate, would not be released publicly for 50 years, 50 years. Why
wow.
is that? Because I think you're going to see many proposals coming in that are asking for very strong special interest breaks for large multinational corporations that members are embarrassed about.
Yeah. We'll pick this up right after
okay.
the break. We'll build it a little more time for a summary of the news here. Stick around. We'll be right back. It's 15 minutes past the hour. Brunch with Bernie here on the Thom Hartmann Program.
This is the Thom Hartmann Program.
And, of course, we're taking your calls now for the senator. And after he gets done with his summary of the news, we will pick them up. So, Senator, we because we had to reboot our phone system, we don't have any Free Speech TV callers on available to us yet. They're calling in right now. So you want to continue your thoughts on the week?
At a time when the middle class is disappearing and poverty is extremely high,
mm-hmm.
and we have an incredible inequality in terms of distribution of wealth and income, how do we create a tax system which is fair, which is just, ends the absurdity of one out of four major corporations paying nothing in taxes, ends the absurdity of many of the multinational corporations able to stash their money in the Cayman Islands, other tax havens, without paying a nickel in taxes on those huge record-breaking profits that many corporations are now experiencing. So the issue is creating a tax system which is fair, which brings in from profitable corporations substantially more than is currently the case. That's the challenge that we face. Knowing the folks who dominate that committee, they will probably move in another direction, figuring out ways to give even more tax breaks to people who don't need it. Another issue that is prominently out there, and I think a lot of concern for progressives and people who listen to this show, is the issue of domestic surveillance. The good news, I think, is that last week in the House of Representatives, you had a coalition coming together of some very, very conservative members and some progressive members who said, you know what, it is not acceptable that every phone call in this country is logged by the NSA, by the United States government. We need to figure out a way that we effectively go after terrorists, but not log every phone call made in the United States of America. And that coalition tells me that I think we can do some good things in the Senate, putting together a similar type coalition. We've got legislation to make Section 215 of the USA Patriot Act much tighter than it is right now in terms of what the government can do. So the issue of privacy, in making sure that the American people do not have Big Brother looking over their shoulder all of the time is very, very important. Another issue that you will be hearing more about in the coming months is the need to raise the minimum wage. Right now, that minimum wage is abysmally low. It's $7.25 an hour. You can work 50 hours a week, 40 hours a week, and 50 weeks a year, 40 hours a week, and you're living, continue to live in really distressing poverty. We need to, today's minimum wage, in terms of purchasing power, is about 30% less than it was in 1968. And we need to raise it to at least $10 an hour. And when you do that, you'll take some people out of poverty. You'll end the fact that Walmart right now and other large, low-wage employers will stop getting the incredible welfare that they're getting right now, because it ends up that many of Walmart's workers end up on Medicaid, end up on food stamps. In other words, the federal government, the taxpayers of this country, are subsidizing the low wages that Walmart and McDonald's and other companies are paying. So those are a few of the issues that are out there, Tom.
Okay. Senator Bernie Sanders is with us. We're going to hit a break here in just a second. We'll be right back, literally just a second, I think. We'll be right back with more of Senator Sanders and your calls for Bernie right after this. And be sure to check out his website, sanders.senate.gov. We'll be right back. It's 20 minutes past. Minutes past the hour of lunch with Bernie. Senator Bernie Sanders on the line in our national town hall meeting. Senator, is there any recapping that you wanted to do of the news here before we get into
it? I touched on what I thought. Some of the issues are student loans, the need to improve a situation which today is a disaster, making it very, very difficult for low and moderate income kids to afford to go to college. I think the current bill, the bill that was just passed the Senate, supported by the Obama administration, and the Republican Party very strongly, makes a bad situation worse. What was interesting about the vote on that one is every Republican in the Senate except one voted for it, and we had, I believe, 16 or 17 of the most progressive members of the Senate who voted against it.
Wow.
And what does that tell you about the nature of the bill?
Yeah, that's not good news. Not good news for students. So would you like to pick up phone calls now?
Let's do it.
Okay. John in Putney, Vermont. You are on the air with Senator Sanders.
Hey, Senator Sanders, proud to have you as our senator from Vermont. Tom opened the show talking about Halliburton and some finagling they did with some records to try to get out of being responsible for the something down with the spill in New Orleans. But which brought me to the point of thinking once again, here's big business, a huge corporation playing games with the system. And it brought me to a place of that I come to often, thinking about the Exxon Valdez and what Exxon has done over the years. They awarded that town, a judge awarded that town, which was destroyed financially by that spill, $5 billion. The last I heard, in fact, a man has written a book about it, they had whittled it down into the millions, destroyed the town, destroyed any means of income.
Because, John, do you have a question for Bernie?
Yeah. I was wondering if he has any idea, sorry for rattling on that,
okay,
about whether they actually were ever awarded anything because they kept it in the courts for over 20 years.
John, that's an excellent question, and I don't know the answer to it. But the point that you are making is that even when a judgment is levied against a large corporation, they have so much money, they have so many lawyers, that they can keep appealing and appealing and appealing and end up paying much, much less than the original sum that the courts determined. You know, and it's the same old story. And when you're talking about a company like ExxonMobil, you're talking about the most profitable corporation in the history of the world, ripping people off at the tax pump, and despoiling our environment. John, that is the point that you raise, is a very, very important one.
Leah Marie in Tucumcari, New Mexico?
Yeah, that's right. You got it. Okay, so Senator Sanders, I was wondering if you could please comment about, and I think it's kind of the same thing with New Orleans, but the comment on what happened in Detroit and how the big three automakers basically helped contribute to the downfall of Detroit, because to me it's really horrifying what happened there.
Well, it's, Leah, thanks. Leah Marie, thank you very much for the question. Actually, it was interesting. I was in Detroit a couple of months ago because we're looking at the issue of youth unemployment, which is off the charts in Detroit. And I talked to a whole lot of really decent kids trying to do the right thing, high school graduates, maybe some with a little bit of college. The best that they can find in Detroit's economy today are jobs at fast food places at 7.25 an hour, minimum wage, and they can't even get 40 hours a week. Now, what happened to Detroit has a lot to do with the deindustrialization of the United States of America, the fact that we've lost well over 50,000 factories in the last 10 years, the fact that 30, 40 years ago we led the world in automobile manufacturing, now the Germans produce twice as many automobiles as we do, the fact that, among other things, it's cheaper for the big three to be manufacturing cars in Mexico, they're moving into China itself, et cetera, et cetera. All of which takes us to the disastrous trade policies, permanent normal trade relations with China, NAFTA, etc., that corporate America has forced on the Congress and the presidents of the United States in recent years. The challenge, Leah Marie, is a very, very simple one. In my view, the middle class does not recover in this country unless you have a strong manufacturing sector, unless we once again are producing the products that the American people consume, including automobiles. And the demand has got to be made on American corporations, including the big three, to produce in this country. But it's not limited to the automobile industry. It's, of course, every major corporation has not only downsized, but they've outsourced a lot of their production abroad. It is a huge issue. We've got to bring the American people together on that demand. Corporate America has got to rebuild our manufacturing sector here in the United States of America, pay workers a decent wage. What happened to Detroit is a real, real tragedy, but it is not just Detroit. We're seeing millions and millions of workers in recent years who have lost decent-paying jobs. They're now scrambling to try to make a living working at McDonald's, Burger King, Walmart. Very hard to do that.
Bernie, 45 seconds to the break. What do you see happening in terms of trade and trade policy over the next few years?
Well, the new trade agreement that's coming up is the trade agreement with the Pacific Rim, Vietnam, and other Asian countries, which I think is pretty much more of the same. That particular trade agreement is being written in secrecy by corporate America. And I fear that it will have continue to have a negative impact on not only working class Americans, but also in terms of some of the pharmaceutical aspects of the bill, negative impacts on low income people in Asia.
Depressing news. Senator Bernie Sanders with us. Check out his website, sanders.senate.gov. He's got the Bernie Buzz, great newsletter. It's a great news site, updated every single day. And you can communicate with Senator's office that way. And you can call in here on our national town hall meeting, Brunch with Bernie. We'll be back in just a moment with more of Senator's.
You're listening to the Thom Hartmann Program. Call 877.
Welcome back, Thom Hartmann here with you, and it's our Brunch with Bernie hour. Senator Bernie Sanders taking your calls in our national town hall meeting. Senator, you're still here?
I am right here.
Okay.
Technology is hanging in.
It is. The cans and the string and the mouse and the wheel and the whole bit, it's all working. Okay, Liz in West Hollywood, California, you are on the air with Senator Sanders.
Hi, good morning, Sanders. Senator Sanders, or afternoon. I understand, I read that, or saw on television, that the post office required, was the first agency to require seatbelts in the cars, and that subsequently led to all of us having the safety of seatbelts. So my question is about computer chips. Why are they made in China? Why isn't the Congress demanding that any chip that's made has to be made in the United States so we can ensure our own security?
Well, Liz, that is a very, very good question. It touches just on an issue that we dealt with a few moments ago. One of the reasons that the middle class in this country is disappearing has to do with the decline of manufacturing. It used to be a time when, you know, folks who didn't have a whole lot of education go into a factory, if they had a union behind them especially, earn good wages, good benefits. To a significant degree, those days have passed. And what we have seen in recent years is corporate America saying, look, why do I want to pay an American worker $15 or $20 an hour, provide health care, protect environmental laws, when I can go to China, Vietnam, Mexico, other lower-wage countries, and employ hard-working people at a fraction of the wages? That has been the plan of corporate America going 30, 40 years ago. That is what they have successfully pushed through, so that every major corporation in America, including the big high-tech companies, the iPhone that you have in your hand, the components were manufactured in China, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And it gets back to the point that I made a moment ago. In my view, if we are going to rebuild the middle class, if we're going to create decent-paying jobs, we must rebuild the manufacturing sector, which means that we need fundamental changes in our trade laws, permanent normal trade relations with China, NAFTA, CAFTA, etc.
Gabriel in Boise, Idaho.
Hello.
You are on the air, Gabriel.
Oh, fantastic. Here, can you hear me a little better?
Hear you just fine.
Hello, Bernie, Mr. Senator. Thank you very much. My question is, how do we convince the 99% group to learn from what happened in the 80s? In the 80s, the Reaganites basically said, go get a job. It doesn't matter if it's a dog catcher. Go run for election. Get anything. And that seems like how they put us in this position now, is because that's what they did. How do we convince the groups that are already working today to do that?
Are you talking about the Republicans got Republicans in political office?
Right.
They did.
Okay, got it.
Okay, Gabriel raises a very, very important question. Way back when, we're going back now, I think, Tom, to Lyndon Johnson's victory in 1964.
Mm-hmm.
The Republican Party and their moneyed interests sat around and said, you know what? We're losing really, really badly. How do we reconstitute the Republican Party? What do we do to make sure that our voice is heard significantly in the radio, talk radio, television? What do we do about building, as Gabriel indicates, a grassroots movement? How do we make sure that our money goes in the right direction to protect the interests of the wealthy and the powerful? And out of that came a huge strategy, which has changed over the years, but it has been enormously successful. The bottom line is you have a party today, the Republican Party, which is a right-wing extremist party, whose views, this is not Bernie Sanders talking, you just look at the polls out there. Virtually every one of their major tenets, cutting Social Security or privatizing Social Security, giving more tax breaks to billionaires, working against the environment, opposing the raising of the minimum wage, asking for major cuts in Medicare and Medicaid, these are ideas that are opposed not just by progressives, they're opposed by Republicans, they're opposed by moderates, they're opposed by people all across the country. And the issue that Gabriel raises, very profound issue, how does a party which maybe has 10, 15, 20% support ideologically among the American people end up controlling the U.S. House of Representatives, governor's seats all over this country. How do they manage to do that? And the answer is they have been very, very smart, starting at the grassroots level. They have had people, and I think this is Gabriel's point, running for school board, running for city council, starting at low levels of government and working their way up. And I think if Gabriel's point is that the progressive community has got to do the same thing, got to get their hands dirty, get involved in local politics. It's not easy. It's not easy winning elections. It's not easy being on a city council or a school board. It's tough work, and often there is very little or no pay at all. But if we are going to be successful in rallying the American people, we need a progressive agenda which stands for working families and the middle class, and we need people to help implement that agenda at the local level, at the state level, and at the national level.
Okay. Hang on just a second here. Cindy in Fort Madison, Iowa. Hey, Cindy, you're on the air with Senator Sanders.
Thank you so much for taking my call. Senator Sanders, it's a pleasure to talk to you, and I'm hoping you can give me some advice on this new Obamacare that is supposed to be coming into effect hopefully soon. Every year, my health care insurance continues to rise, and it's almost as high as your house payments now. I'm hoping that it is going to go down, and I guess I don't understand how this is going to work, where because I don't think the insurance company is going to send you a letter saying, oh, your rates are going down, you know.
Cindy, do you get individual coverage?
Yes, okay. I do.
All right, here's what the story is, and I voted for Obamacare. I voted for it because it will bring some 30 million uninsured Americans into health care. We've managed to get a whole lot of money for community health centers, for the National Health Service Corps, a lot of good things at disease prevention. But I will tell you, as a strong advocate of a single-payer system, that the current Obamacare program is much more complicated than it should be. But, Cindy, in terms of your particular case, what it means, and I'm not sure how it's being implemented in Iowa, what it means is that depending on your income, you will be able to see on your on a website the competing programs that are available to you in the state of Iowa, and you will make the best choice based on your needs. And the belief is, and we've seen this being true in California and I believe in New York State as well, that because individuals now have got to have some form of health insurance, and the pool is becoming wider, we're seeing a drop in what insurance companies are charging individual consumers. Furthermore, depending on your income, you will also be eligible for a federal subsidy. So the hope, at least, and it's certainly appears to be true in California already, is that because more people are in the pool, your insurance rates from the competing insurance companies should go down, and B, depending on your income, if you're low or moderate income, it is very likely you will get an additional subsidy from the federal government. That is the theory. In many cases, it is working. We'll see how this whole thing plays out.
Mike in Hempstead, New York. You're on the air with Senator Sanders.
Yes, Senator Sanders, I just want to thank you for your service.
Thank you, Mike.
First off, you're welcome. And also, you're a voice of sanity in this crazy corporate greed wilderness. And that's a point I have, and then a quick question. It's basically all corporate greed, and they're the ones running the show right now. And to me, the Supreme Court has also helped that along, of course, starting with Reaganomics and the Glass-Steagall and all that. But how come Obama's not, and if that would be, I think, the answer to some of it at least, or starting the ball rolling, to getting the Supreme Court leaning the opposite way since it's been leaning conservatively? It should be leaning fairly and, I think, progressively to the left by replacing possibly Kennedy.
Mike, we have just a minute. Let's let Bernie answer.
Mike, the short answer to your question, obviously, is the president can't appoint people until there are vacancies, and he has appointed some reasonably good justices since he's been in office. If vacancies arrive, you know that the Supreme Court is now tilting 5-4 right wing. And my hope and expectation is that if one of the justices, the more conservative justices, retires, that he will replace that justice with a more progressive justice. But in terms of your first point about corporate greed, you hit the nail on the head. What we right now have is a corporate world that could care less about the average American. Their goal is short-term profit. Wall Street is living in a world unto itself. Unless we address that issue, I have not a whole lot of hope about the economic well-being of the middle class of this country.
We'll be back in just a minute with more of your calls for Senator Bernie Sanders in our Brunch with Bernie Hour here on the Thom Hartmann Program. Check out Bernie's website at sanders.senate.gov.
You're listening to the Thom Hartmann Program. Visit thomhartmann.com for audio and video archives.
It's 15 minutes before the top of the hour. Again, Bernie's website, sanders.senate.gov. Welcome back. Terry in Silver Springs, Nevada, watching on Free Speech TV. You're on the air with Senator Sanders.
Hi. The VA hospital that used to give cash travel pay at the time of the visit has now changed to a direct deposit. My husband got his first deposit, you know, within the month, and it was $15 less. Can you tell me why?
I may be able to tell you why, but obviously I'm not familiar with the particular case. The VA moved toward a policy which I have pushed them to change. I'm chairman of the Senate Veterans Committee, and I think they have changed it, but the changes may not have gone into effect yet. Kerry, here's what the story may be. What the VA wants is for veterans to get their primary care at a local community-based outreach clinic rather than traveling long distances to a medical center. What I have urged them to do, and they have, is to say that if a veteran has a physician at the medical center, for example, that he or she has been going to for a number of years, they should be allowed to continue to go to that physician at the medical center and get all full travel costs. Otherwise, what the VA has been doing recently is just giving them travel costs for what it would have taken them to get to a local CBOC, local community-based outreach clinic. That may be the reason. But what I would do is call up the hospital. If the case is that your husband wants to continue to see the physician at the medical center, at the hospital, make that very clear. And if he does, I think he will continue to be able to do that and get full travel compensation.
Diane in San Jose, California. You're on the air with Senator Sanders. Thanks for watching Free Speech TV.
Hi, and hi, Bernie.
Hi, Diane.
Oh, hi. Bernie, oh, God, you're so loved. And I hope I sound okay. Sometimes I'm kind of frantic.
You sound fine, Diane, but we only have a few minutes here, so it needs to be short.
Okay. I used to be a counselor at the shelter for the homeless, and it so saddens me to know in the Santa Clara County there are 7,000 homeless people. You know, so I had a thought the other day. Years ago when I volunteered for Jerry Brown, he bought a house for a dollar through HUD, and I was wondering what you might... He bought a dollar and he used it for an office, and I'm sure you know about the program, right? I mean, you know, when HUD gave people houses for a dollar, mm-hmm. and then they fixed them up.
Mm-hmm. So should we revive that? Is that your question?
That is,
yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Bernie?
You know, there are a lot of uninhabited homes in this country, homes in which people were unable to pay their mortgages because of the Wall Street collapse. And it is absurd that when we have a housing crisis in many parts of the country, when we have people who are living in their cars or out on the streets, that we're not having people living in homes. So I think Diane suggests one idea, but the bottom line is clearly We do have a major problem with regard to homelessness, housing crisis, affordability issue, and we've got to address that very aggressively.
It is Brunch with Bernie. Senator Bernie Sanders taking your calls here in our national town hall meeting. Brunch with Bernie. We'll be back with more of Senator Sanders right after this. Occupying the media 3 hours a day, 5 days a week. Tom Hartmann here with you, and it is our Brunch with Bernie hour. Senator Bernie Sanders taking your calls. Joan in Alexander, North Carolina. You're on the air with Senator Sanders.
Yes, Senator Sanders. As I understand it, Obamacare goes into effect in October of this year and will be required to get health insurance, which my husband and I don't have. And if the governor here, McCrory, has decided not to accept Obamacare or institute it, I assume that means that there would be no federal assistance for getting health care.
Yes.
And therefore, we'd be charged with what, a crime?
No. No. You would not be charged with a crime if your state was not involved in the program. The point is what Obamacare, the two important parts of a, well, two of the important parts of Obamacare is, number one, to expand Medicaid to 15 million people who today are not eligible for that. Now, I don't know what your income is, Joan, but if the state of North Carolina got into the program, you might well be eligible for Medicaid, which would not cost you a nickel. The other part is another 15 million people will be able to get health care through the exchange in, depending on their income, fairly heavily subsidized rates. So people get a pretty good deal for health care. But if North Carolina is not in the program, you're not going to be held responsible.
Okay. That's a very interesting question. Jim, in Littleton, Colorado, you're on the air with Senator Sanders. Jim?
Oh, shoot.
You're on the air.
Actually, it's Lone Tree. I had a question for you, Senator. Why don't we go to a 32-hour work week? And if to stop them from manipulating the system, make overtime double time, and get rid of business having to deal with health care, and switch it over to, like, in the insurance system, get rid of Medicare, Medicaid, and legislate the insurance companies into taking in everybody. And that way we take that burden off business.
All right. Well, Jim, you've just proposed a revolution in the United States, probably not going to be passed by the United States Congress, who are heavily dominated by corporate interests. Let me just touch on a few of your points. We are the only nation in the industrialized world that does not guarantee health care to all people through a national health care program. The result is that we spend almost twice as much as any other country. Our outcomes are not particularly good, and tens of millions of people have no health insurance at all. Ours is the most complicated, wasteful healthcare non-system in the entire world. And what Jim focuses on, he makes a good point. You know, why is it that businesses themselves have got to supply healthcare to their employees? This came about during World War II for a variety of reasons that we don't have the time to go into now, but there is no rational reason for that. Healthcare should be a right of all people, paid for by tax dollars, administered in an efficient way by the government. The United Kingdom does that. Canada does that. Denmark does that. Countries all over the world do that. And the result is systems that are much more cost-effective and much more universal and allow, importantly, businesses to do what they're supposed to do, that is to function on what they do, rather than get involved very heavily in the complicated and expensive issue of providing health care. So the answer to your question is, Jim, you're right. It should not be businesses providing health care. It should be the United States government through a national health care program, in my view, a single-payer system.
Marcia in Inglewood, Florida. You're on the air with Senator Sanders.
Hi. I love both of you. I'm just so confused by the conflicts in Congress, and most especially with President Obama, the mixed signals that I get from all of them about what direction we're heading, what we should be heading in, and especially with Obama promising all this transparency in government and doing the total opposite.
Okay, Marsha, let me jump in. Very, very good question, and let me try to explain it as best I can from my perspective at least. Here's what you got in Washington right now, and I'm probably the only member of Congress who will tell you this. On one hand, you have a Republican Party that has become moved away from being kind of a moderate conservative party years ago to a right-wing extremist party. What do I mean by that? What I mean by that is you have many people in the Republican Party who now, for example, not only oppose raising the minimum wage, which virtually all of them do, you have most of them now believe that we should abolish the concept of the minimum wage, that if workers, say, in a high unemployment area like Detroit, would work for $3 or $4 an hour, then that would be fine. No government protection in terms of what a minimum wage should be. There are many Republicans who not only believe in cutting Medicare and Medicaid, they believe that it is unconstitutional for the United States government to be involved in health care at all. Only the private sector insurance companies should be doing that. So you've got a right-wing extremist party, heavily dominated and funded by corporate interests like the Koch brothers. Then you got a Democratic Party that has also moved pretty far to the right, is now, instead of being a party that it was, say, under Roosevelt and Truman, a party really identified with the working class of this country, has become kind of a moderate party, a centrist party, good on a number of issues, gay rights, women's rights, some degree to the environment, but also heavily dominated by corporations in terms of economic issues. Much better than the Republicans, to be sure, but not terribly strong in fighting for working people. And you have Obama, who is a centrist Democrat. So in terms of the economic struggle, which is how you take on Wall Street and the big money interest and deal with the decline of the middle class, the very high level of poverty, deal with the incredible power, both wealth and power, that corporate America and Wall Street have, should we expect that the president will really take on those very powerful special interests? And it's not going to happen. That's not where he is about. He will be somewhere in the middle, a fight for raising the minimum wage, for doing this, that, and the other thing, but not really lead the frontal attack that we need. So that's kind of politically where I see us at this particular moment.
Thank you, Bernie. Thank you so much for being with us today.
All right. My pleasure, Tom.
Thank you, Sam. We'll be back.
You're listening to Thom Hartmann.